what came to me. So, you know, when we think about the outside forces, you know, that shape us, you know, the first thing that, you know, we might think about is the circumstances of our birth and our DNA. You know, there's a lot just in that we have absolutely no control over. That's a lump of clay, right? Our DNA, you know, it's like, you know, what race you're a part of, what sex, you know, you are. I mean, that's just, and even like where you are. If you were born in India or, I don't know, China or Congo, you would be having a different, you know, experience of you than you're having here right now. I'm pretty sure of that. I know I would be. So your parents and your family, your socioeconomics have, you know, a profound impact. Your community and your education, you know, have a shaping influence on your life. Friends, the friends that you grew up with, the friends maybe that you went to school with in high school or college, your adult friends, you know, they all play a role in shaping your life, your work, and your career. You know, that's where in our adult life, you know, we spend, you know, most of our waking hours, you know, and that definitely has an impact on us. And then the choices that we make in life, you know, actions have consequences, right? Choices, you know, have lingering impacts in many cases, and mold and shape our lives in a lot of different ways. And then we could continue with that. There are other things that impact our lives, you know, from the outside. Misfortune, stuff happens, right? We talked about the value. You know, it just happens. Car crashes, all kinds of stuff. Trauma that people suffer, often, you know, at the hands of other people. You know, it's like I was just going along minding my own business and this thing happened. You know, and not because we did anything wrong, not because we need to be punished or anything else. It just happens. But it has a profound impact on our lives. Illness and disability, which has a profound impact not only on our own lives, but on the lives of those around us. We pray this morning for those who are caregivers. Anyone who's been in that role knows, you know, how profoundly impacting the experience of caring for someone who really is suffering and struggling with health. Addiction, another one, you know, if you've been in relationship with someone struggling with addiction, or if you yourself are a person, you know, there's a lot of stuff that presses on you from without. And finally, losses. I mean, this isn't a comprehensive list, but, you know, losing loved ones, losing a job, losing, you know, opportunities that we had our hearts set on, maybe going on a vacation and, you know, something happened that you couldn't do it. On and on, you know, so there are a lot of things that push on us from the outside. Sometimes want to make us, you know, conclude that, you know, it's all spiraling out of control. And sometimes it does. But then, you know, what are the inner forces? You know, how do we meet? You know, what's going on inside with, you know, what's going on in outside? So, you know, again, this is where I think we have an opportunity to not just be a lump of clay just waiting for God to do everything for us, but where we get to actively interact, you know, with the process of being formed into a beautiful work of art. So this, you know, again, not a comprehensive list, but some things that came to me. So the first thing that stood out to me, you know, as I was thinking about this, was that attitude. Just like how we encounter the circumstances of our life. And then I was thinking, okay, so what's a scripture that goes with that? And here's one that always speaks to me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. I love that. Not 50% of your heart or, you know, some fraction thereof. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. See, my own understanding, it looks at the data, looks at the stuff that's happening out here, and says, I'm not so sure, you know, anyone's in control. I'm not so sure anyone's, you know, helping me out. You know, your prayer this morning, you know, sometimes it's a mystery, right? I've joked about walking around, you know, like after the Valley Fire, you know, walking around like Tevye and your filler on the roof, you know, he's walking around. You know, would it be so hard, you know, to give us a little help here? You know, so you know, but trust the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding, which is going to tell you it's all, you know, going to hell in a handbasket. Instead, acknowledge Him in all your ways, not some of your ways, all your ways, And here's the promise. He will direct your paths. You can find that in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Okay, so that's one thing. Second thing I think that, you know, can help us is, you know, just willingness. You've got to be willing. You know, we talked a little bit about, you know, AA and recovery. You know, if you're struggling with addiction, that problem isn't going to get solved by God or anyone else unless we can find within ourselves, somewhere near that center, you know, some willingness to do some things. You know, the expression, you know, keep doing what you're doing and you'll continue to get the same results, you know. So we got to be willing to try something new, to do something different, change our behavior. And you know, the scripture that came to me in connection with that was just Jesus on he's in the Garden of Gethsemane on the edge of in the evening in which he's arrested, and he's knowing some really bad things are about to happen to him and to all the people that he loves. And so he's praying. And his prayer, you know, is like, can we do it some different way? Do we have to walk this way? But he concludes the prayer, nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. You know, I'm pretty sure if I was in that situation, I'd be struggling hard to come up with that. But it is, you know, it gives us something to reach for, something to aspire to, something to be inspired by. Nevertheless, not thy will, but mine be done. I don't know why all this stuff is happening, but, you know, determination. So, you know, so we get a little bit of willingness, and then we got to follow through. We got to be, you know, kind of determined. Try hard. Anyone who has, you know, wanted to do something, I don't know, you know, get fit in the gym or learn to make pottery or, you know, something, you got to have some determination, you know, to work through it. And so we could go to Paul talking in the book of Philippians, I could do all things through him who strengthens me. So it has something that speaks to me about, you know, on the inside. So if I'm willing to do some things, you know, some energy comes into me, you know, that makes it possible for me to exceed, you know, what I believe is. It's a colorful world, it's a beautiful world that we live in. It's a colorful world, it's a beautiful world that we live in. So, yeah, so. It's a colorful world. She wears nose rings with weird things floating through her hair. She is slightly embarrassed by everyone who stares. And when she walks away, you might say she's a little wild. But she could rule the world when she opens up her mouth and smiles. It's a colorful world that we live in.
Every hand you touch has a friend with a deal.
Super important. You know, I think we all know that. You know, I was reading this newsletter, you know, CrossFit newsletter. I'm a little bit into that right now. And, you know, but it's about, you know, doing exercise and getting strong and increasing your endurance and so forth. And so there's this, you know, the topic is 10 ways to increase your mental toughness. Item number 7 was gratitude. And this tripped me up. You know, this is like, you know, how to get stronger and, you know, fit and everything, but how to develop mental toughness, which you need to do that determination and all that. Be grateful. Being grateful is a massive mental shift. Having a mindset of gratitude puts you in a productive state to do your best work. I like to spend my car ride to work each day just thinking about the things that I am thankful for. My family, my loved ones, opportunities for growth and fitness. When I catch myself having a negative mindset, I immediately stop and focus on what's right in my life. Being negative is a habit. Being thankful is a habit too. So you can go out of here and you can be driving home and you can be thinking, oh yeah, there's all this cool stuff happening in my life. I'm blessed. And finally, the last thing, you know, that came to me is about choosing the path of love. You know, that again, we're focusing on the forces on the inside that push against all that stuff that's pushing on us outside. Choosing the path of love. And, you know, probably many of you remember seeing the movie Forrest Gump and his mother, Sally Fields, you know, teaching her, love is as love does. You know, don't tell me you love me and don't act that way. Love is as love does. So we get to practice that, and that changes us. And so, just as sort of in a joking way, it changes us in ways, you know, that are really important. So this little cartoon, love is caring for each other even when you're angry. No small thing, right? No small thing. But it pushes out against that stuff that's pushing in on us and turns us into a beautiful thing. We can turn to the Dalai Lama, you know, pretty cool guy. And he says, if you want others to be happy, practice compassion. If you want to be happy, practice compassion. See, you could go out the door with that, huh? I learned something cool in church today. I learned how to be happy. Not too bad. And just to finish up, so Jesus says basically the same thing. It's all about love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. It's all about love. God is the potter, and our job is to love, to learn to love. So just to conclude, you know, this little saying from Ezekiel chapter 36, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. Amen.
Amen.
So we wanted to just finish up, just so you can have a little meditation time. We have this song. Some of you might have been around in the 60s. You might remember a song called Get Together. It's all about love, learning to love, making the choice to love, kind of put in a hippie kind of way. But please join in if you remember it.
You can make a man.
it's time for offering of gifts. Please know that gifts are also giving of yourself and of your time. Calvin, would you mind collecting the offering, please? Compassion for others is imperfect, yet your love and patience is boundless. We bring our gifts to your altar and pray that in the loving hands of the potter, they might be made beautiful, reshaping the world in beauty and in love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So I would like to invite, if you do not have a church home, we would love to have you here. We have open hearts, open minds, and open doors, and all are welcome. Before we end, I would like to also thank Pastor Karl Parker and Ron and Esther for doing the music and for being and sharing here with our service. And it was fantastic the second time, just as good.
Thank you, and thank you for your support and helping us as worship leader. That made things really easy and fun for me. So we want to end with, you know, just like a little sermon and song. They'll know we are Christians by our love. And I bet you know this, if you're able to stand and join in, and let's sing it with gusto.
With each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk.
So, the closing prayer. You know, for preacher kind of people, it's like, the temptation is to give the message after the message, you know. But, you know, they'll know we are Christians by our love. You know, not by our position on, you know, political issues or who we vote for, not by the bumper stickers that we put on our cars, or, you know, any of that stuff. They'll know we are Christians by our love. And I kind of think that's the reason why Jesus, on the last night that he was with the disciples before he did that other prayer, he talked to them about a bunch of stuff, and I get this sense of urgency. Like, he really wanted to download a bunch of stuff because he was going to be gone for a while. And so you know, in what he talked about, three times, you know, as John records it, love one another as I have loved you. This is going to be the way that people know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. I think that's so trippy, so powerful, you know, such an important message. Love one another as I have loved you. So that's a kind of special kind of love, right? So we love one another in that special kind of love. You know, not self-serving, not selfishly, but other-centered, merciful, compassionate, loving. And we go out into the world through those doors, and we get to do that. We get to do that. All those outside forces are pushing on us and everything, but we can get centered, like we did here this morning together. Thank you so much for being here. And we get to go out, and we get to meet those challenges with that love in our hearts and that love that we carry in us. Tom says it's time to go. Shut up, Karl. Thank you for being here. God bless you.